I call this meeting to order at 7:43 p.m. Roll call.
President Harris.
Present.
Vice President Mortis.
Present.
Treasurer Joseph.
Present.
Parliamentarian Anzalone. Present. Executive Secretary Gates.
Present.
Senate Chair Porter.
Present.
Student Trustee Capellas.
Present.
Senator De La Rocco. Senator McDonald. Also absent. Senator Morangelo.
Present.
Senator Patel. Absent. And Senator Quay.
Present.
Great. We have two voting members present. So we did not meet quorum. So we will, in the agenda, we will be going over approving the agenda for September 7th, 2021, and approving the minutes for the meeting for April 27th, 2021, because we do not have quorum. So we're going to move on to invited speaker. I would like to make a correction to the agenda. I wrote the wrong title for Dean Denine. She's Associate Vice President, not Assistant Vice President. So sorry. So tonight we have Dr. Joseph Oravecz, Vice President of Student Affairs and Enrollment Management, and Dean Denine Rocco, Associate Vice President and Dean of Students. We will still be in Robert's Rules, so if anyone has any questions or comments for Dr. Joe O and Dean Denine Rocco, you will have to raise your hand and wait to be recognized by me. But Dr. Joe O and Dean Denine, you have the floor.
Thank you all. This is so exciting. How many hundreds of days have we seen each other behind Zoom screen or in the Zoom scores and everything like that?
Yeah.
We actually now have to get dressed up. So this is good, and it feels good. Everyone looks marvelous. Thank you for our students to be able to hear it looking, to be able to see how you might want to become more involved with student government. So lots of things that are happening on our campus, and I just want to be able to first wish those that are celebrating starting last night at sundown, Rosh Hashanah, so a happy new year for our faculty friends and students, most importantly, that are celebrating. I want to make sure that we do that for you guys. All so many different celebrations throughout the entire year. So as we are moving through this particular back together again, which is really important, that is the theme of what we used to call the Safe Return Task Force. But it is really important that we are together and how we are excited to be able to see each other. I think you and I even had the student involvement fair yesterday. It was just reinforcing for me that we are all parched for that social interaction. That's why we never ever use the phrase social distancing here at Bridgewater State. There's always physical distance, because we want to make sure that we actively, in the best and most safest way, to be able to have that engagement, that social engagement. So if you can just bear with me, there are a couple of different things I want to make sure that I go over with you. But first and foremost, as far as the value of student government at Bridgewater State, and expectations that we have for you. You are the elected voice, and the student voice is one of the strongest voice at Bridgewater State. You have the opportunity of making change. Caitlin, is it better if, should I stand over there? I'm just making sure you're for over here too.
Better.
Okay,
go ahead.
Got it, okay. One thing with the masks, and I also recognize, is that sometimes I even want to watch people's lips move so that I can make sure. And I apologize for that. So as the elected student voice, you have an incredible opportunity of advocating every single day for what students need. Now, I was kind of thinking when Tyler and I had a chance to visit, I was really. There are certain things as student government, as an elected leaders and such, to really think about, well, how can I invoke change? You all that were part of student government last year, and even a semester before that,
had the opportunity of doing a lot of really, really good things. And how did you do that? Number one, you listened. You listened to your peers about what is it that might need to change, or what are some things that we need to improve upon as far as faculty, staff, and administration. And then, second, after you listen, you research. You research kind of what does that mean, and what are other institutions doing? And are we kind of, is this an outlier, or is it something absolutely that we need to do? So you listen, then you research. And then you start talking to other student groups. Those are a coalition building. Okay, you're just not doing it on your own, but you're listening to other student organizations to make sure we have it right. That is what you do as elected student leaders. Then you listen a little bit more to those student groups. From there, you start visiting with a lot of us, with Dean Denine, with myself, with President Clark, to be able to say, these are certain things that we are hearing, that we are advocating for, that we have researched. And finally, and we propose a change, or we propose something doing that will make it even better. So with those steps along the way, and that's through an advocacy board, through a variety of different ways, you are able to make change. An example is changing the name of the Rondolo Campus Center to the Rondolo Student Union. Okay, that was all of you talking, and it was like, we want this to be the heart of the students on campus, and we're able to make that. There's a lot of other things that you're going to be able to do, but that's sort of as far as your role, what my expectation is, what President Clark's expectation is. Dean means a variety of everyone being able to make sure that this is what you are here for to be able to do, and we want to help you along that way. So that conversation, that you know how accessible we are for you, to making sure that, hey, you have these questions, or what do you think about? And we want to be able to make that happen. Another example, and then I'll switch my topic, is the Rondolo Student Union Bronze Bear. That came up from students to be able to say that we don't have a place to go to celebrate, to recognize, to appreciate for one another, for bears in the past, present, and future. And with that, by the student idea of being able to move that forward, we have an incredible bronze bear now that we're able to gather around. And it's been absolutely wonderful to see students in their caps and gowns, taking photos with families as they are arriving to drop their student off, to have those photo ops. And so it's something that, and I encourage you to think of some traditions maybe that will be able to happen with the bronze bear. So, so what I'm going to share with you, I'm not going to go over everything, but I think I have my
take one and pass it down.
So I'm sharing with you all from the Division of Student Affairs and Enrollment Management, our priorities for this year, that I want to make sure that we are holding ourselves accountable. And that's why it's important that I share it with you. Yes, we have enough for the gallery. Okay. Thank you very much.
Sure.
So you will see the core priority in the columns is racial justice. That is something that we want to make sure that through our own employees and the programs that we put on for students, that is the core. More education always needs to happen, and that is what we are committed to do through training for our employees as well as training for students and student leaders. Mental health is a core, these are all core priorities, and we will continue making sure that mental health is at the forefront because in addition, the physical health and mental health of our students, especially coming through this pandemic, is critical. So we will continue to do that. We have a mental health task force. We're still moving forward with regard to that. Student engagement is absolutely critical, as I indicated before. That social engagement piece is really, really important. And so we expect more opportunities for students to be engaged because in order to be, when you're engaged, then you're connected to one another. You're wanting then to continue on and enroll for subsequent semesters. So that is another opportunity that we're looking to be able to do. Organizational health is organizational effectiveness. So we are always learning how we can do better as far as communicating with each other and making sure that we're making the right decisions for the success of our students and how they're structured. And strategic planning, you need to constantly plan. And what we're doing, there's two different parts. One right now that I want to focus on is enrollment management. And when we talk about enrollment management, you all apply to BSU. That's one piece of enrollment management with financial aid. And then you're also are registering for each semester, so that's called retention and persistence, and then actually graduate. And we have had plans in place, but we are doing much better because we have a enrollment planning committee comprised of faculty and staff to be able to move forward as far as the next 3 to 5 years. We use a lot of data to be able to see how we might be able to grow our student population. And what are those areas that we're going to grow through? I will be more than happy to in the future to come back and explain to you a little bit more about what that looks like, all right? But so again, in part, these are what, for me, what I've developed as far as priorities for the division, as in what you all are doing as student government, you all have your own goals and your priorities as well. I always want to make sure that our priorities are in alignment with the president's priorities. We don't want to be offered by ourselves. Those are all the different divisions have it very similarly as well. We have our own variations of the president's priorities. So I think with that, lastly, I just want to bring you up to speed with the Racial Justice Task Force. And our executive vice president and provost, Dr. Smalley, is leading that charge with the recommendations with the Racial Justice Task Force. And just today, shared with Pat, the structure that we're looking to move forward with. One key component, so there will be a Board of Trustees Committee on Racial Justice. And there is going to be a student advisory group that we're going to be looking at a variety of different formal student organizations initially that we'll be able to ask for on this respective student advisory group. And the Martin Richard Institute for Social Justice will actually be kind of the organization that will help make sure that the different initiatives are following through. All the vice presidents have responsibilities with regard to the Racial Justice Task Force and the recommendations. And I think Deb and I will be sharing more with Tyler, President Cherish, as we finalize what those will be. So I appreciate your time. I appreciate how I went a little bit longer than I wanted to, but there's a lot to cover since we haven't been here in person. And so that is something I'm always more than welcome to have you guys be at lunch for any additional opportunity for us to clarify anything that might be going on. And with that, I just want to be able to get over to Dean Denine to bring you up to speed with where things have come specifically. But are there any initial questions? Go ahead. Oh, sorry. We're still in Robert's rules.
Student trustee with Alice.
Thank you, Madam Chair. So regarding mental health, I have been on SGA for 3 years. And for 3 years, I've seen this as a core tenet of student affairs plans. For 3 years, I've watched students' mental health plummet. And I'm not trying to blame you because there's a variety of factors that cause this. I don't really see anything different. If what we have is not working, then why are we continuing?
I appreciate that. And for every year, yes, there's been additional layers as far as what is compounded. So it's compounded. Mental health is compounded. And so we do know as far as students taking advantage of the services that we're offering. So I have to say it did dip a little bit last year because of COVID. And we are doing more as to be able to push out more information to students so that you are aware of what those services are. So in part, we have established a mental health awareness committee. And so that is being finalized as far as pushing out more information about what is available to students. So if you don't know what is out there, you're not going to use it. However, then it's upon us as the university to push out more information so that you're available. So from a variety of apps that we have with Togetherall, WellCheck, as well as the hybrid of counseling services, be it virtual or in person, one thing that we're going to be rolling out, my hope is, during the month of September, is an additional training for student leaders and for faculty and staff to be able to have conversations with peers or with students about where the resources are. It is a program, and you can even pull it up here, it's called Kognito, with a K, Kognito, so it's not incognito, but Kognito, that we have purchased and we're moving through our Director of Counseling Services, Donna Sciallo, is going to be able to, should expect to see more and more of this pushing out. I would, my hope is by the end of September, you should become very aware of what that is. So we are enhancing the additional services. And so as we are seeing if there are more requests for counseling services, we're going to have to look to be able to see, do we enhance more of the counseling staff or not, or what are the more specific things that we need? So we have added use. Hasn't been as much as we would hope, but what we found is that through the survey that we did last December for you all, trying to see kind of what things are available, we had an incredible high response rate. The one thing was, I'm not aware of certain services. So that's on us to be able to push that.
Awesome, thank you.
Gallery,
sorry.
Member?
I just want to ask, what mental health services are currently available for the school?
So the question is, what services currently exist?
Yes.
All right. So we have, through the Wellness Center, we have clinicians, licensed mental health counselors, that they're able to do both in-person and virtual telehealth for that. There's some group counseling that is happening as well. You have the, and what I would recommend too, is if you go on the mobile app, you're able to, to be able to know exactly where to go on the mobile, because you're able to go on to Togetherall, as well as WellCheck. So there's on the website for wellness, you're able to go on to there. And then also for crisis and such, you have access 24 hours to counsel. We contract with a company called Protocol. And so that if you're calling the wellness number, and if it's 2 a.m. and you're with a friend and you're just not sure what's going on, you can call that number and they will work, help you work through that. And if 911 needs to be called, 911 needs to be called. But if there's other conversations that have, so when we look at ourselves compared to other institutions, we're doing a good job. Can we do better? Absolutely. But we're responding to what the needs are to the students, as opposed to just saying, no, we're okay. Does that help, Joe?
Yes.
Okay. Great.
Vice Senator Morandella.
Hi, thank you so much for coming today. It's always a pleasure to see you in person.
Wow,
this is a treat. So I have a question about the plank around organizational health.
Yes.
And I see that it aligns with goal 3 of the strategic plan.
Uh-huh. Because you are wonderful carrying around the university's strategic plan, right?
Yeah,
that's awesome.
And so there are two things. I noticed both the organizational strategic plan and your strategic plan doesn't really address the fact that I think that a lot of departments, both in your division and other divisions, are short-staffed and under-resourced.
Yeah.
And I know financial aid, I've had a lot of experiences with them where they haven't called me back after a half hour, like I've been on the phone for a half hour, they didn't pick up, or no, they didn't email me on the phone for half hour, they didn't answer, and then I had it took like five days to get an email back, and I emailed Oravecz to sort of prod things along. So, and I know OSL is short-staffed. I know there's a hiring freeze, but I think this is an issue before the hiring freeze. Like, I think it's just a matter of resources, but also sort of time management, figuring out what the best use of resources are. So I guess my question is two parts. What plans are there to sort of use resources more effectively? I know we had a reorganization of OSL recently, but also part of goal three is to advance opportunities for faculty, librarian, and staff professional development, and whether there are opportunities in your division for staff to, to have professional development,
yes,
to better serve students.
All right, so there's a lot to unpack right there. But what I'm hearing two things is staff and the amount of staff that is available or not available. And the second is staff development, right, professional development. So yeah, I can absolutely say as far as looking for staff development and positions through our budget, and it has been looking to be able to look at enrollment. So this goes back to our strategic enrollment. So what drives our budget are students that are enrolled at the university. And so we have definitely seen over the course of the last 3 to 4 years, a decline in the traditional age students. When I say right now traditional age student, that's the 18 to 25 year old. Okay? And so with that, when we're seeing a little bit of decline, that impacts the budget. And so through President Clark, through the cabinet, our CFO, Vice President Shropshire, to be able to see what are we able to support and what are we not able to support. First and foremost, what's supporting is the curriculum and the faculty to be able to deliver the course content. But we know that to balance kind of what you're learning inside of the classroom, you also need to have support outside of the classroom. So we try to advocate, we want to make sure as far as the priorities that are critical to the mission of the institution. So people might say, well, all positions are absolutely critical, and they are. But what we then have to prioritize to be able to see what is it that we need to be able to hire. And then with the pandemic has caused more of that hiring to be on a pause, because the president's commitment is that we want to retain the staff and employees that we have. So you might hear of Salem State and some other universities where people were forced to take time off, what we call that furlough. Or people were laid off because of jobs, that the money was not there. Bridgewater State, because of President Clark, did none of that. So in order to balance that, we are a little too essential staff, but people are able to keep their jobs. So there's that balance there for that. And that hopefully as we grow enrollment, and I can honestly tell you, across the region, so in New England, that traditional high school population, if you really look from K through 12, is declining. Numbers are shrinking. And so everyone is going after the same student. Through our strategic enrollment planning process, we've identified there's another population that is growing. So that would be the post-traditional student. So that is 22 to however old you want to be and still taking a course. So there's a lot of people that started going to school, stopped, want to finish that degree. There are companies now, or have been in the past, that actually will pay their employees to go on and complete a degree. These are different approaches of graduate, our College of Graduate Studies, our College of Continuing Studies, more programs online, because the post-traditional might be a single parent who has one kid that wants to complete a degree. I'm a single parent, one kid. I've got enough degrees. But however, might want to go back, right? So I'm one of that target. You know, to think about, hey, you might have a family member that might be one of that population to be able to advance. So that is moving very specific to see what kind of programs we might be able to grow that population. So that's, and we've been able to do research in the data to see that there is quite a lot of post-traditional individuals in this area that would be interested. But we haven't done a very good job marketing them, so we need to grow that as well. Sorry, I went in a different direction. I didn't talk about staff development. You want to follow up next?
No, it's late because I'm a post-traditional.
Okay, all right, no, exactly. So staff development, I've never cut any budget as far as professional development. That is one thing that I think across the university, each vice president is charged as far as what they want to be able to do. It's up to the directors in the division if we have to cut any budget where they might want to cut. But I have absolutely firmly believe that as an institution of education, that how can we cut education for our own respective staff? Now there's differences in that let's try to be efficient and effective with the dollars that we have available. So if there's virtual attendance as opposed to going to a conference that might be in North Carolina or in Florida and such, we want to be very conservative with our travel. And really, there are travel restrictions now. But if there's an opportunity for professional development, I have absolutely been looking at all that. Good. All right. Any other?
Vice President
Ortiz. You said that there are. Are there counselors currently in the wellness center, or is everyone still
there? There is physical presence in the counseling center, and so there is a rotation as far as who is present, because there is that opportunity for employees to telecommute, and that is up to the executive director to be able to say, okay, you're here on Mondays, you're here on Tuesdays, you're here on Wednesdays, that sort of thing. So there is presence in the counseling.
Executive Secretary Gates.
This is just a question, just because I'm curious, not necessarily because of anything. You mentioned how there was a decline in college-age students, or traditionally college-age students, and an increase in maybe not non-traditionally aged.
Post-traditional.
I apologize. And how that, you originally had mentioned how the decrease in traditionally college-age students affected the budget. Does the age of the student affect how much money the university gets?
No, maybe I misspoke on that then. I apologize. It's more or less overall, it's just overall enrollment impacts the budget. So it doesn't matter on age at all.
Right, that's what I figured.
No, it's just more or less of when we're seeing K-12, and for those of you that are from Massachusetts, you know DESE, which is Department of Elementary and Secondary Education, they have this whole website that has all this data. So we know right now, as I was on another meeting, might have been 3 months ago, when they were just like, well, you know, are we going to, for our residence halls, you know, are we going to be able to make sure that we have enough space for all the students coming on in? And I'm like, we already know in the year 2032, what's the potential of how many students are going to be graduating from high school. We're able to plan that far. And so you can see it's declining. So we need to start changing now, because they're still going to come. But if we focus on the kindergartens and those that are in kindergarten and first grade, you already know there's going to be less. So where is there more? There's more in the post-tradition. So let's start talking about that. Not to say that we're not going to stop planning for the traditional students, but you need to balance the portfolio. Any other questions?
Gallery member?
Later on experiences and the needs of the upperclassmen who came in pre-COVID and had experience, and the underclassmen who had no experience in college. Do you believe that the current plan in place is large enough to encompass the needs of the very polarized different student classes?
So did everyone hear the question there? Alright, so could be a perceived polarization of upper-class students that had a different experiential education, learning experience, co-curricular, than those that are in the last 2 to 3 years. So, one thing that I realized probably was in March, April, that, and I talked to some of you about this too, is that the seniors, current seniors, I will just say, I'm sure there's a clear point, but the current seniors are the only cohort that has experienced a full year in person at Bridgewater School, right? That's it. So the, oh, well, this is what we used to do, you're the only one to have a clue about it. No one, so the majority of our students, the majority, this is all brand new, right? I know some of you that are sitting here, your freshman year was last year, and was all behind a screen. So there, you have the opportunity of creating something new. I would challenge the upperclassmen to say, you know, if there's some things that we didn't get right, change it. Because it is complete blank slate to be able to create these brand new traditions. So that's what and in talking with our division, and I mentioned it when I mentioned this last spring to the president, and then everyone just realized, like, holy cow. We didn't really have that perspective. And I tested it during our student athletes compliance meeting when I asked for those that have not experienced a full year at Bridgewater State in person to please stand up. We had about 450 student athletes in the RSU auditorium. The majority of everyone stood up. So this is for us as far as faculty, staff, employees to understand that the majority of our students don't know what Bridgewater State University can really do. So that's the perspective that we really need to take. And if there's all, you know, been looking at the leadership experience that's coming from those that have been here longer, you all have the opportunity of saying, this is how we make change. This is how we create new things. So you have a lot more responsibility than you might have thought you had. I'm gonna head it off to you.
Dean Denine Rocco, you have the floor.
I apologize, I'm doing this. Are we on?
Thank you.
Madam Chair, thank you for the invitation. Good evening to you, to President Cheris, Vice President Morris, Trustee Capellas, Executive Board members, Senators. If I may, Madam Chair, deviate just a bit from my remarks, there will be a method to my madness. We are being videoed. Hello out there, YouTube. I would like to mark this first Senate meeting by asking each Executive Board member, Trustee, and Senators to come up, introduce yourselves, and mark this moment, starting here, if you wouldn't mind.
Hello, everybody. My name is Asher Gates. I'm Executive Secretary for the Student Government Association. This is my sophomore here at BSU, and I'm studying political science and English.
Hello, everyone. My name is Aiden Mortis. I am the Vice President of the Student Government Association. I am a junior here at BSU, and I am studying elementary education and history. I've never actually used this before. Hi, everybody. My name is Tyler Cheris. I use he, him pronouns. I am the president of the Student Government Association this year. I am a senior, and I am majoring in political science with a concentration in American politics. And it's I'm excited to start the year with you all.
My name is Mariah Porter. I am your Senate Chair. I am a senior, double majoring in psychology and allied until a few weeks, then I'm just psychology. I'm a senior, yeah. She, her.
Anything else
you
say?
All right,
see ya. Hi, my name is Alexis Anzalone, but people call me Lex. I'm the parliamentarian, I'm a senior, and I'm studying biology, and my minor is psychology. I use she, her pronouns.
Close enough? Yes, no, hopefully so. My name is Joshua Joseph, and I am the treasurer. I am a senior, and I'm a double major in economics and finance. I do a lot of things on campus, so I'm also the vice president for the accounting and finance networking club, the CEO of the Bridgewater Collegiate Investors, and treasurer for the Sigma Chi fraternity.
Hi, I'm Artie Coppelas. I use they, them, their pronouns. I am currently the student trustee among a million other things on campus. And I'm studying social work, communications with concentration in film, in our studio with a concentration in photography.
Hi guys, I'm Jake Clay. I am your senator. I am a sophomore and I'm majoring in mathematics and secondary education.
Hello, my name is Max Marangello. Yeah. I'm a senator, a senior, and I'm studying political science with a concentration in public administration. We had a lot of accomplishments over the past. We got we work on the part-time teams in the middle. It's the pass policy crew, and we're really proud about that. So, just an example of what SGA can do.
Well, thank you all, ladies and gentlemen at home, and ladies and gentlemen of the gallery. In addition to acknowledging the student government advisor, Caitlin Dolesky, I am just proud of your 2021 student government. Yes? All right. Let me also acknowledge the holiday, so Shana Tova. And also, let me also acknowledge what September is. Trustee Coppelas brought this issue to the fore, so let me say that September is Suicide Prevention Awareness Month. I am sure that all of you will support our student organization, in particular Active Minds, so let's give them a shout, as well as the many other events and activities that will shed light onto, particularly on college campuses, the importance of, as I said, shedding light on this really significant area. We know that that's just not one month, that happens all the time, so let me just say that. And I bring that to the table because it's part of education, right? And Dr. O talked a little bit about all that's happening throughout the university, what our university priorities are, what the priorities of the Division of Student Affairs and Enrollment Management are, and you all will have an opportunity to bring your priorities forward. And as Senator Marangello said, you have accomplished a lot. You come into this chamber on the shoulders, if you will, of those who have come before you and set really, really a strong foundation. I'm being rather formal tonight because I'm acknowledging the role and the formal role that you hold, each and every one of you, on this campus. We're relying on you. We know that you are setting forward and stepping up, if you will, to your commitment to serve your fellow Bears. And so, you know, in my role, I look forward to championing your work along with Dr. O and so many others on campus. So please do feel free to reach out at any time. I'm going to talk a little bit about student engagement and the importance of that and the important role that you play. So we talked about education. it's important for you to know what's happening across campus so that you can take that information and share it with your constituency groups. Yes? The key to that, I would say, is showing up. Yes? So there are a number of chairs absent tonight, and that's something that all of us as administrators in a peer group need to acknowledge and recognize. I'm so thrilled at the number of people in the gallery, and I do hope that we see some involvement. I've already heard tell that applications are in, so President Cheris, he will be full shortly. Anyway, a little bit about student engagement. The Center for Student Engagement is an intentionally and newly created space here in your student union. I do hope that each and every one of you take advantage of the opportunity to explore that new area, the physical space that it is, and the refresh that has happened to that space led by your very own advisor, Caitlin Gillespie. So thank you, Caitlin, it looks really great. But also to explore the opportunities that will be provided to all of you therein. Explore the opportunities that will be provided to all of you therein, and encourage your constituency to take advantage of those opportunities as well. You know, one of the things that, as Dr. O talked about the senior class, over the last many days, I've had a wonderful opportunity to engage not only with many of you who are seniors, but other seniors who have been at different events or activities and have said, we didn't have this when I was a freshman or a first-year student or a first-year transfer student. And you know what I responded? I said, we're stepping up our game. and indeed we are. And so, you know, that's where we'll rely upon all of you. If you don't think that we're doing good enough, it's your voice that will take us up and over a particular hurdle or bring information to the fore, as I said, as you have done and as your folks before you have done. So please don't be afraid to challenge yourselves, push your personal boundaries, set your intention for the year. Yes? Other than that, I'm going to keep it short. I know we went a little longer, so I just want to say thank you. We're relying on you to do your part in ensuring that this campus community is one of connectedness, a welcoming environment. I already know that you are Jedi warriors. For those of you who do not know what Jedi warriors are, I'm talking about social justice, equity, diversity, and inclusion. That too will be the hallmark, I think, of this Senate and your work this year as a student government. So I wish you well. I look forward to working with you. And again, Madam Chair, thank you for the opportunity to say hello tonight.
Thank you. Any last minute questions or comments for Dr. Joe O or Dean Denine before they depart, if they so choose? You're welcome to stay, of course, but we do know it's late, so I'd understand if you want to get home to the dogs. Seeing none, we're gonna move on. So thank you so much for coming, both of you, and speaking, and we cannot wait to continue to collaborate with both of you throughout the year. So next up, we have club and organization reports. Definitely check out Engage BSU for some upcoming events. When I made this agenda on Friday, there was not many on Engage BSU, but there will be more. Advisor Caitlin.
Thank you. I do want to specifically highlight a service project that's happening on Saturday through the Martin Richard Institute for Social Justice in remembrance of 9/11. It is an off-campus community service opportunity, but it is listed on Engage BSU, so I really recommend that you check that out. It will be helping to fight food insecurity for our local communities, as well as here on campus. So please do check that one out. And there are a lot of events got approved today through our office, a lot were processed, so please check out engage.bridgew.edu. It's also linked on the student portal. And yes, and on Friday, there will be a 9/11 remembrance event at 10 a.m., 11 a.m.?
11.
11 a.m. On Boyd and Quad. So please stop by for that.
Senator Morangelo.
So I don't know if this is the appropriate place for this, but I did reach out, or a representative from LSL reached out to me regarding just their club, and they said they were confused by the new Engage BSU system, so I just thought I'd pass that along, that there's still a lot of confusion from the new clubs with the new system, so I just wanted to throw out that some clubs might be feeling that.
Totally makes sense, absolutely. I know if anybody is confused or anything, or someone reaches out to you, a good resource is having them email bsuinvolved@bridgew.edu. And there's someone monitoring that email during office hours, or business hours, of course. But they know all Engage BSU. So definitely recommend reaching out to them. Or walking down to RSU 103, where Center of Student Engagement is, and there will be a smiling face to help you navigate the involvement world at BSU. All right. Next. Oh, Student Trustee Kopalis.
Thank you. Also, if they are confused, they can email their advisor through also. I believe cultural, oh my gosh, I'm so sorry. Root Center of Student Engagement. I believe the multicultural clubs are through Tori right now? Matt. So, since they're a multicultural club, they would email Matt Miller, and I'm sure he'd be willing to help if not happy.
All right.
So many mistakes were necessary.
Next up, we have executive reports. President.
Hello, everybody. I am welcome to the 2021 to 2022 school year. It is great to see you all here. It's great to have a big gallery for our like for us. And basically, just to echo what everyone has been saying, our mission as a student government organization is to ensure that your voice is heard, as Dean Denine was stating, because your voice matters. This is a great year to capitalize on the energy that we are going to be seeing in the coming weeks, in the coming months. And the way that we are going to be able to capitalize on that is by utilizing the most important thing to every single student on campus, and that is your voice. And I'm very much looking forward to continuing that work with you all throughout this year. And just in another update, unfortunately, due to academic difficulties, the Senator of the College of Business, Senator Wojcieszka, is resigning just to focus on themselves and their mental health, which is completely okay. And you have, and that is the end of my report.
Thank you, Vice President.
Hello, everyone. Welcome back to the 2021-2022 school year. Got a lot to report tonight. For our lovely senators, training will be October 2nd from 10 a.m. to 5 p.m. We're going to be giving a lot of info, some of the info from the last training session, a little more in depth into some of it. We're going to also be goal setting for the year as well. Other than that, I'm so excited to see so many people in the gallery.
Harland Treasurer.
Well, as of right now, we currently have $70,000 in the budget allocated to events, and more will be added by October. And we currently have 77 active groups registered.
Thank you. Parliamentarian.
Hi, everyone. I don't have much to report. I have received one constitution for our new club, but I have to wait for a board to approve it. Other than that, I'm excited to see everyone in the audience and my report.
Executive Secretary.
Hello, everyone. Just to reintroduce myself, my name is Asher Gates. I'm the Executive Secretary. So I will be continuing minutes in a minute from last semester. That was something that the former executive secretary, now student trustee Kopalis, had started. And so if anybody, an executive board or senator, is interested in doing that after this meeting, please feel free to come up to me. Otherwise, I will be finding somebody to do it, and whether it be myself or one of you. So please, if that is something that interests you, please come up to me. And yeah, other than that, that is the end of my report.
Student trustee.
Hello, folks. I almost spoke for executive secretary, so I guess I'm still getting used to this role. But I have my first executive meeting on the 14th, and other than that, I need some senators to volunteer for the honorary degree committee. I don't know the dates for that yet, but once I find out the dates, I will be sure to share them with you and report.
Senate Chair. I want to start off my report with a land acknowledgement, actually. Bridgewater State University recognizes and respects the indigenous people and their relationship with the land, and believes the acknowledgement is an important part of raising awareness and keeping history from being suppressed or forgotten. We respectfully acknowledge that Bridgewater, MA, sits on the lands of the Wampanoag Nation, whose histories and hardships have not always been told. Land has meaning. Our lands and waters should be honored and protected. To put that out there. But also, we have had 8 senator applications so far, and the applications have only been open for 6 days, so super duper excited about that. They do close September 22nd at 5 p.m. So if any of you know anyone who's interested, or any of you know anyone who's interested, definitely feel free to send them my way or send them the link to apply. My email is posted everywhere and anywhere, but if you want it, feel free to come up to me after the meeting and I will pass it along for those who are still on the fence about SGA. If you have any questions about anything, also feel free to come up at the end of the meeting and we can chat. And applications close again September 22nd at 5 p.m. And with that, nothing further to report. Next, we have board reports, executive board.
Hi again, everybody. Nothing much to go over here. At eBoard today, we just basically stated, went over what we expect to get out of this year and how we are going to do it. Throughout the coming weeks, we are going to continue to have conversations regarding that. And something that I also forgot in my executive report, I apologize for saying it now, but committees are very important to student government. They are, BSU has a variety of committees and each senator must serve on them. And of course, attending those committees will count towards your office, your required office hours for student government. So at the end of the meeting tonight, if you, the senators could please just come up to me, I can explain to you what, in more detail, what a committee is, what committees need student representation on them, etc., etc. And the same goes with boards. We have every single of our lovely eBoard members has a board, and they need someone, they need students on there to help push our respective, the missions of each respective board further. We have the advocacy board, chaired by Vice President Mortis. We have the finance board, chaired by Treasurer Joseph. We have a policy board chaired by Parliamentarian Antoloni. We have the public relations board chaired by Executive Secretary Gates. And then we have the elections board chaired by our Senate Chair Porter. So please come up to me just after, for a couple minutes after the meeting, and we can get that squared away. And other than that, end of report.
Next, we have advocacy board.
Hello again, everyone. I just want to start off saying before I talk about advocacy board that all of the boards are open to the public, which means all of our lovely people sitting in the gallery are more than welcome to come into any of the boards except the executive board and listen in on all of our conversations. Feel free to talk about your concerns, voice your concerns, everything like that. All the meeting times will be posted on Engage BSU once executive board members figure them out with their board members. Speaking of the advocacy board, which is the board that I chair, advocacy board is the board that helps to listen to the needs and concerns and issues of the students, our constituents. Members bring issues that they've heard from their constituents to the board, and we come up with solutions to
figure out how to help the student in the best way, whether this is dining, parking, stuff like that. So, Senator Chair, she's doing up to work up to talk to President Chair after. And gallery, once we have an advocacy board time available, we will be putting it on, or I'll be putting on Engage BSU, so you're more than welcome to time to the board. Other than that,
next, we have Finance Board.
Hi again. So, Finance Board monitors funding of any project or event that SGA is financial supporting. We take care of looking over the budget and seeing if they fit within the guidelines. If it surpasses the $3,000 amount, we take it to Senate and over collectively and report.
Next, we have Policy Board.
Hi everyone. So Policy Board basically reviews the bylaws and the club constitutions. We review them in our board and then we approve them and then we bring them to the Senate to go over. So yeah, basically stuff like that. And Vice President Horn said, once we figure out time, we will have all the time posted for all the boards on a new basis and report.
Public Relations Board.
So just a brief description of what Public Relations Board is. We are in charge of creating any and all marketing for the and outreach for the organization. So that's through our Instagram, updating our bulletin board, our Twitter, et cetera, as well as any posters that we may need to put up around the school, amongst other things. And it is also one of the primary forms of communication between the students and the organization. Of course, there are definitely other ways of communicating within the organization, throughout the organization. So, yeah, that's end of the report.
Next, Elections Board. I'm the chair of Elections Board. Basically, what we do is ensure all elections are run in accordance to our rules, make sure they're fair and accessible to all. We go over elections rules to make sure that they're meeting the needs of today's student, not 1970s student, although they matter too, but that's not what the year we're in. We also review potential Senate applications, the candidate applications, that's a better sentence for it, term, I guess. We review those to make sure they meet the standards, such as being an undergraduate student and maintaining at least a 2.0 GPA. So if you're interested, senators, feel free to join. Also open to the public, except the one that we're selecting. We're going through applications for candidates, as that contains personal information. We cannot really share that to the public. That will also be posted on Engage BSU. Nothing further to report. Committee reports. I had a committee meeting today, and I didn't know I had a committee meeting when I made this, so I'm going to talk about the committee I went to today. I went to Space Committee today. My notes are on my phone. This is widely impressed. Space Committee. So RSU was changed to an educational building, and by doing that, they only need 3 new fixtures rather than 30, which is a dramatic change. There's also going to be a subcommittee for Rendezvous Student Union placement of offices. I'm going to be on that subcommittee. There was also a sign created to put into all classrooms about who to call in regard to technology concerns or room state concerns. During the committee, we also spoke about Cyber Range. And Cyber Range, which is kind of a program that BSU is hoping to do, that'll enable students through academic programs in the IT security office to practice their IT security skills. And CyberRange provides scenarios for people to work through, and they're looking for space for it. If you're interested in learning more about CyberRange and what BSU is hoping to do, the Rochester Institute of Technology is a prime example of what BSU is trying to do. They're trying to aim for fall 22, but depending on what happens in regard to space, that deadline might be pushed back. Also at BSU, there's an Enterprise Risk Management Register, which calculates risks in their priority, and a medium risk was not having enough space on campus and forcing student groups off campus to have their events, and we spoke about that. And also, we are going to, the committee is going to look into how space is utilized on campus and how much students want to actually hold in-person events rather than virtual events. And yeah, that is the end of my report. Anything else for committee reports? Senator Morangello?
I do owe you a AUC committee report from last year, but I don't have anything written up yet in front of me. I work on that.
It's totally okay. When you can, you can. It's okay. Anything else for committee reports? Committees are also open to students, not just on SGA. So President Cheris can appoint you to that if there is a committee that you feel very passionate about. I'm also on dining committee, and we're meeting, I think, next week. I was not able to go to the first meeting of the semester because I had class or work, one of the two. But we will be meeting soon. Anything else for committee reports? All right, old business. Anything for old business? Seeing none, moving on to new business. Discussion of dining hall hours. So this is also an opportunity for anyone from the gallery to speak regarding dining hall hours. It can also be just about how you're feeling about the dining halls, but keep in mind they are short-staffed and they are getting used to having very high capacity, which they haven't had to deal with in 18 months. So please try to extend dining services some grace in this time where things, like many offices on campus, severely understaffed. But does anyone have any concerns, comments, questions? Gallery member?
I have class from 8 a.m. till 10:45 on Tuesdays and Thursdays. And by the time I get back to try to go to the ECC, they close from 11 to 12, which is tough on my schedule. I've also, on a side note, I've noticed a decline in some food availabilities, such as some removal of foods, which...
That's all. Advisor Caitlin?
Can I just ask a follow-up for you? Is the decrease in food in ECC or another dining area? I'm just curious where you're seeing that.
From all dining
areas, but okay. A lot from ECC, such as like the kind of Greek yogurt, cottage cheese. Thank you. That's helpful. Anyone else? Student
trustee Capalis. So I did have a chance to speak with Stacey. I do not know Stacey's last name, but she is the general manager. Wait, Stacey Simone.
Woo!
Yo. She's the general manager of dining, and there are one main concern I hear is that Dunks is not open. I'm a big fan of Dunks. The reason it's not open is because the person who was trained to open it did resign, and they are working on training another person. Their hopeful opening date will be in the mid-October. Stacey also echoed that 32 below, which is, I think, gonna be an ice cream bar in Bearsden. It's not a staffing issue, they're just waiting for equipment. other than that, they are still actively seeking out new staff. They have positions posted on every website you can think of, like Indeed, all those websites. They are on local community boards for the area surrounding Bridgewater, and they are going to job fairs. Like, any way you can think of to recruit people, they're doing it. They're also actively hiring students to fill in the gaps, which I think is really cool, because any way that a student can get a job is a good thing for students. So I fully get every concern regarding dining hours. I'm not usually the one to defend dining, but they are surprisingly doing their best.
Thank you. President Cheris?
Just to echo what Senate Chair Porter said, give grace to the employees, just because
I see, I've talked to, I've, sometimes I'll just have a conversation with them when I'm ordering a burrito bowl or a chicken sandwich or anything like that. And it's just important to just make sure they're heard as well and make sure that they're working so hard. Every time I go into Crimson, it is packed. So just asking them how their day is, can go a long way. So just keep that in mind when you're ordering food as well. Reciprocity is key to moving forward.
Anybody else? Dean, Denine, Rocco.
I also wanted to acknowledge that we're well aware of the length of time it takes to get through the lines. And so that is part and parcel to employment, but also to sort of getting the into the sort of groove, if you will, of timing of classes, et cetera. So I wanted to acknowledge that. And then lastly, for those of you following along on the mobile app, I did want to let you know that Mr. Matthew was supposed to be here today. Actually, he's in the hallway, so if I can just go out and get him to reveal that he is here. And if you all don't know what that is about, I would encourage you to continue to follow the mobile app. Okay, well, he's gone. Nonetheless, that's just a plug for all of you to follow along on the mobile app and do include your input onto the mobile app. He'll be at the next meeting. Thank you, Madam Secretary. Or Madam Chair, I'm sorry.
Also, if you have any issues that occur at the dining hall, a big thing is don't wait on it. There is the option to text the chef, who Joe Pina, he is the executive chef of campus, or simply go, I need to speak to a manager, in a non-caring way, of course. We need to be polite. They are, as we all mentioned, they are understaffed. But do not wait on your issue. Get it addressed as soon as it's happening. So for the next customer, it doesn't happen. Because if we're waiting a month or 2 months, then that thing could have happened to so many other students. So make sure you're getting it addressed when you can and as it's happening. Senator Way.
I would also just like to add that when it comes to dining feedback and things of the like, the BSU mobile app is not, in my opinion, it's not the most effective way. Yes, everyone has an account, but not everybody checks it. So just keep that in mind, that maybe take advantage of other resources before.
Thank you. Anything else for discussion of dining hall hours? Seeing none, we're going to move on to open forum. Open forum is a section of the agenda where anybody can bring up anything within reason and as long as it's appropriate, even from the gallery or senators or e-board members. And this is your time to speak about what you want SGA to listen about. Is there anything for open forum? Treasurer Joseph.
So when we were tabling on Monday, there was this one student who had an issue with the low amount of options for vegans. Healthy vegans. They only had, what was it, vegan patties, I believe?
Yeah.
And they would like that to be changed.
Student Trustee Capellas.
There's an entire new place for Crimson that is devoted to vegan and vegetarian options. But other than that, as somebody who meets with a food restriction on campus, there needs to be more options. I think this is messages that we can bring on to dining, but nobody in this room can currently fix that.
Is there anything else for open forum. Senator Morangelo?
Yeah, so I wanted to, you know, last year we talked a lot about racial justice, the Racial Justice Task Force, and what we as SGA are going to do to try to sort of work on ourselves and try to improve ourselves on that issue. And I just want to make sure that we're going to continue to do that as we move forward into the new academic year.
Absolutely. I absolutely, absolutely agree. It's something that is definitely at least in the forefront of my brain, and it's something that I definitely want to work on SGA being better with, and collaborating, if possible, with student affairs and enrollment management, and collaboration to make, honestly, BSU a better place in regard to racial justice, because there's more that we can be doing, and our work isn't done, so let's just make sure we're holding each other accountable to make sure we are getting that insanely important work done. Anything else for open forum? Alright, seeing none, we move on to announcements. Announcements is when we go around the table in that order that I just motioned and give announcements. It does not have to be SGA related. It could be like, hey, I'm doing really good today. Or it could be like, I think Dasani's garbage. And gallery, feel free to also provide announcements once we get through the line. But starting off with Dean Denine Rocco, do you have any announcements?
No, thank you.
if you don't have any announcements, feel free to say no announcements. No pressure.
No announcements.
Thank you, Dean Denine Rocco.
I do want to announce that part two of the involvement fair will be happening on September 22nd on University Park from 11 to 2 p.m. Please come out. We'll have probably many more organizations than we had yesterday. We had a great turnout yesterday, but we are excited to provide a second opportunity for folks to learn about the other organizations on campus. That is also the deadline of the application for SGA. So, two for one with that deal. Other than that, I just encourage you to stop by the space downstairs in 103, come say hello to our student engagement assistants, and just check out what opportunities there are on campus to get engaged and involved.
I just want to say Shana Tova to all who celebrate Rosh Hashanah and are observing this year. I actually shouldn't be here, I should be resting, but, you know, couldn't miss SGA, so I thought it would have a little observance with that. But and I just want to say it's good to see everyone, and let's get started.
I don't know.
I just want to say I'm so excited to see everybody here in person. As somebody who lived on campus last semester with everything online, it is great to see everybody today, so end of announcement.
I'm going to go the opposite. As someone who lived at home last semester, so excited to be back on campus and see everyone and see the campus bustle. I was talking to President Chairs today as in the RSU, and it just made me so happy to see everyone walking through. Even last night at RSU takeover, just seeing that many people together again made my heart happy.
Yeah, I'm going to echo exactly what Vice President Mortis said. It's great, 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 great to see everybody back on campus again. As someone who lived on campus for the majority of last year, it was honestly really depressing to just wake up and then open up my laptop and then finish a class. For the lazy folks, I'm sure that sounds amazing, but I like to be in the classroom and be able to just experience the culture that BSU has to offer. And I'm really, so far, it has this year has exceeded my expectations as to how this school year is going to look so far, and I cannot wait for it to continue. So I'm very, very excited for this year. I just wanted to mention a couple things. It was mentioned earlier, but it's worth repeating. This Saturday will be the 20th anniversary of September 11th, and this Friday, September 10th, at 11 a.m. at the Boyding Quadrangle, there will be a 9/11 Day of Remembrance. It's recognizing the 20th anniversary. However, if there is inclement weather, it will be in the RSU outside the Legacy Office or the Lewis and Gaines Center for Inclusion and Equity. And I also just wanted to echo again that the second involvement fair is on the 22nd of September, and again, that is the deadline to also submit your candidate applications. Looking at all you back there. if you have any questions about running, what student government has to offer, why you should be part of it, feel free to ask any one of us up here. We are more than willing to tell you what it's like. We promise we're not biased, but we are biased. But other than that, it was great to see you all tonight, and I cannot wait for next week's Senate and every Senate meeting thereafter.
Hi everyone. Just to go off what everyone's been saying, it really is great to be back and have a normal-ish year. This last year was really rough, rolling out of bed and going on the computer. I hope everyone's classes are going good, mine or not. But hope everyone else is. I'm really glad to see everybody here. I hope you all do SGA because it was honestly one of the best decisions I made for coming to this school. That is it.
To repeat what everyone said, it's great to be back, it's great to see everyone. So our first part is County and Finance Club meets this Thursday at 6:30 p.m. in Library Room 104. And I have a quote from the great Elon Musk. I think it's a great quote because sometimes you feel like the cards are stacked against you and gotta always fight through it. So here's the quote. When something is important enough, you do it even if the odds are not in your favor. End of announcement.
Hello, folks. So I want to start by first acknowledging what Dean Denine Rocco already acknowledged, in that it is Suicide Awareness Month. I am personally a survivor of suicide. And I want to remind people of not just the resources we have on this campus, but of suicide hotlines. I do not know them off the top of my head. They are saved to my phone, though. But there is the National Suicide Hotline. There's also the Trevor Project, which is specifically for LGBT people under the age of 25. I also want to remind people that LGBT people, especially youth, are at, I believe it's, I don't remember the exact statistic, but they are much more likely to die by a suicide than other populations. Lastly, please refrain from using the word commit suicide. We often associate commit with acts of violence, and as violent as suicide can be, it is not in itself a violent action. And yeah, that's my soapbox. Getting off my soapbox, I am part of this lovely organization on campus called The Comet. The Comet is a student newspaper on campus. If you are planning to join SGA, you will hear about them every single week. We are finally publishing papers again. I know some of you are freshmen, but it's been over a year and a half since I've been on my InDesign, laying out a paper, planning for stories, and I would love to see as many new writers as possible. I would love to see stories about campus life and student profiles that we would never think of. So if you are interested in writing for The Comet, please email our editor-in-chief, Geshe Fraser. You can email myself as well. Or you can come to our meeting at 6 on Thursdays. We meet downstairs in RSU 105.
005?
Sorry, we meet downstairs at RG 005. We have our own office. And we also have that office door open as much as we can. You can come in and talk to any of our editors that are in there and say, I would like to write a story about the new Shang-Chi movie, Seven Rings. I hope I got that right. And we would say, go ahead. That's all. All right, Bob.
Anyone from the gallery have any announcements? Go for it.
So I'm just going to ride as far as National Suicide Prevention Month, so thanks for bringing up, because again, the student voice was very loud and clear, and so we are moving in the direction of the bear ID that everyone has. On the back of that, which has been ordered, will be eventually the suicide prevention hotline. Do you have a new one that's not over here? Or I know that in the next quarter, that's going to happen. And that is, again, because of the student voice through Active Minds that came through that. So again, just for those of you that are new to BSU, understand that the power of the student voice is great. And we'll do that. So thank you. It's great to see everybody.
Any other announcements from the gallery? All right. It's me, I guess. I do stand by my Dasani trash thing. I stand by that. Anyway, I would love to see any and all of you run SGA. Applications close at 5 p.m. exactly, not a second after, on September 22nd, 2021. Also, for those who live in residence halls, please be kind to your RAs, please. We are going through a lot of changes departmentally, so be kind. And yeah, with that, that ends announcements. This meeting is adjourned at 9:04 p.m. Woo!